for me to introduce Martin Balko on our regular seminar. He's from Otfis, a common friend of ours, and he will tell us something about the expected number of holes in a random point set. So,
okay, thank you. So, hello everybody. So I will share my screen and start. Okay. So I hope that you can see my slides. Full screen. Okay. So thank you for the introduction. So I'll be speaking about a joint work that we have together with Manfred Schecher from Germany and from Pavel Valtr from Prague. And it's about the expected number of holes in random point sets. So let me start with the famous result, the famous Schecher theorem from 1935. And this is a seminal result which says that for every positive integer k, every sufficiently large point set in general position, meaning that there are no three points lying on a common line, in the plane contains k points in convex position. So we are given positive integer k, and we want to set sufficiently large size so that every set of points of that many points in the plane in general position contains k points in convex position, meaning that those k points are vertices of a convex polygon. So let me illustrate this on a picture. So assume that k is equal to 6. So we want to find 6 points in convex position, and assume that this many points is large enough point set. Then no matter how our point set looks like, it can look, for example, look like this particular point set S, we should be able to find 6 points that are in convex position. And indeed, here we have these 6 purple points that, as you can see, are vertices of a convex sixgon, and therefore they are in convex position. And again, if our point set has sufficiently many points, then it doesn't matter how does it look like, there will always be such a k-tuple of points. Now in this talk, we will be not really interested in points being in convex position. Instead, we will look at somehow more restrictive k-tuple variant of this problem. We will be looking at so-called k-holes. So a k-hole in a point set S is again a k-tuple of points that from S that are in convex position. But additionally, we would like them to contain no point of S inside the in their interior of their convex hull. So for example, this purple six-tuple of points, it is in convex position, but it is not a six-hole, because inside the interior, inside the convex hull of these purple points, we have 3 points from S that lie inside, which is not allowed in the six hole. So this six tuple is not a six hole, but there are some six holes, for example, this orange one. So here again, we have 6 points that are in convex position. And moreover, there is no point of S in the interior of that convex hull. So this is a valid six hole. And in this talk, we will be interested in the existence or in the number of such k-holes in general. And let me state some very basic results. So it is known for a long time, and it's actually trivial to see that if we have at least 3 points, then we always have a 3-hole. It's somehow less trivial, but it's still easy to show that if you have at least 5 points, then you will be always able to find a 4-hole among them. And finally, it was shown by Hubbard in the 1970s that if you have at least 10 points, then you are always guaranteed to have a 5-hole. This is very non-trivial, and it was a whole paper about it, but it's true, and it's actually the least amount of points that you need to find a 5-hole. So these results led Erdős in the 1970s to ask the following question. Is it true that for any positive integer k, if we have sufficiently large point set, then we are always able to find a k-hole? Somehow, this would be an analog of the Erdős-Schecher theorem, but for k-holes. And this was answered negatively, this question of Erdős, by Horton in the 1980s, as he constructed arbitrarily large point sets that contain no 7-hole. So already if k is equal to 7, there are arbitrarily large point sets that have no such 7-hole, and therefore the answer to the Erdős question is no. An example of such a point set is here. This one has 16 points. And no matter which 7-tuple of points you choose from this set, they will not span a 7-hole. They will either not be in convex position or they will be in convex position, just like these purple ones. But there will be some points of S inside the convex hull, like, for example, these two points. So these Horton sets, they do not have seven holes, and therefore the answer to the dash question is no. However, these Horton sets have plenty of six holes, for example, this orange one. And for a long time, it was not known whether we are always guaranteed to have a six hole in every sufficiently large point set in general position. And this was eventually settled independently by Gerken and Nicolas, and they proved that indeed every sufficiently large set of points in the plane in general position contains a six hole. So for six holes, the answer to Erdős's question is yes. This settles the existence of k-holes because, to summarize, we know that every sufficiently large set of points in general position contains a k-hole if k is at most six. And if k is at least seven, then we do not have, then there are point sets that do not have k-holes. So the existence is settled, and now we can ask, how many k-holes do we actually always have? What is the minimum number of k-holes that we have in set of n points? So let's introduce a new parameter. Let hkn be the minimum number of k-holes that we have in any set of n points in the plane in general position. So this is the minimum number of k-holes that we will always have in a set of n points. So what do we know about these numbers? So we know the following bounds. First of all, for three holes and four holes, so if k is equal to three or four, we know that there are point sets that have only quadratically many three holes or four holes. And on the other hand, we know that in any set of n points, we have at least quadratically many three holes and also four holes. So altogether, we know that the number of three holes and four holes grows quadratically in n. So here the asymptotic question is settled. We know what it is. It's the quadratic function. For five holes, it becomes more interesting. So first of all, we know that there are examples of point sets, of sets of n points that have only quadratically many five holes. But the lower bound is somehow weaker. It's not quadratic. It's not quadratic anymore. So for a long time, we only knew that there are at least linearly many five holes, and this was open for decades. And it was widely believed that the answer should be quadratic, that we also have at least quadratically many five holes in any set of endpoints, but nobody was able to prove that. And a few years ago, we had a breakthrough together with a group of people from Prague and from Graz, and we proved that there are superlinearly many five holes. So we now have this superlinear lower bound on the number of five holes. And this actually settled a conjecture that was open since the 1980s. But still, it's a difficult problem, and even though everybody believes that the answer here should be quadratic, nobody can prove it. For six holes, the gap is even wider. We have, again, quadratic upper bound, and we have only linear lower bound. But again, everybody believes that the number of six holes should be quadratic in n, as for the other cases. And let me just recall that if k is at least seven, then the answer is zero, because we have the Horton sets that contain no seven hole, and therefore no k hole with k at least seven. Holes were also considered in higher dimensions. We do not have to restrict ourselves to the plane. So for example, Pavel Valtr constructed d-dimensional analog of Horton sets, and that is sets that contain no k-holes for any sufficiently large k, which now depends on dimension. So for example, in three space, we now have a construction of sets that do not contain, I believe, 23 holes. And we know that any set of endpoints or that any sufficiently large set of points in three spaces, we will always have seven holes, but the cases between them are open, and we don't know what the answer is. Another result of this flavor in larger dimensions is the bound on the minimum number of d plus one holes, also called empty simplices. So this was proved by Barani and Firedi, and they showed that the answer here is asymptotically n to the d. So we have always at least n to the d empty simplices, and this is also, there are also examples of set point sets that have n points and have only asymptotically n to the d empty simplices. So those are the results about arbitrary point sets, but in this talk we will be focused on random point sets. So we will somehow consider a random model. So let k be a positive integer. This will be the size of the host that we will be looking at. And let capital K be a convex body in the D space that has unit volume. Now we will mostly, or we will consider only this parameter EH, which is the expected number of K hosts in sets of endpoints that are chosen independently and uniformly at random from our convex body K. So we have our convex body of unit volume, and now we are drawing independently and uniformly endpoints from this convex body. After we draw them, we ask what is the number of K holes, and then we are interested in the expected value. So the expected number of K holes is the parameter that we will be studying. So this is not a new parameter. It was considered by many authors. For example, Barani and Firedi showed the following upper bound on this expectation, which is again of order n to the d. This was improved by Pavel Valtr in the plane, as he proved that the expected number of empty triangles in the plane is at most 4 times n^2. And this is actually tight, because very recently Reitzner and Temeshwari showed that the leading constant in the expected number of empty triangles is equal to 2. So the expected number of empty triangles is 2 times n^2 plus some smaller order term. Reitzner and Temeshwari also proved other bounds on the expected number of empty simplices. Again, we know that this number is n to the d, so they focused on the leading constants, which are defined as these limits. And they proved that the leading constant here is at least 2 over d factorial, and it's at most this complicated expression, which uses the volume of the d-dimensional unit ball. And what is interesting about these bounds on the expected number of empty simplices is that the upper bound is actually tight. So this weird looking creature is actually tight if our convex body is an ellipsoid. If it is not, then it might be lower than that, the leading constant, but it's always lower bounded by this 2 over d factorial. So this is what we know about the expected number of empty simplices, in other words, d plus 1 holes. Now, what we proved, what are our results about this expected number? So first of all, we extend the previous bound to larger holes. As you could see, all the previous bounds in this random setting were about empty simplices. Nobody considered K holes for arbitrary large K, okay, so we somehow looked into it. And a few years ago, we already proved an upper bound on this expected number of empty of K holes, which is of order n to the d for any fixed k. So this is our theorem one, but this is somehow all the result. We proved it 2 years ago. And just to recall, it shows that the expected number of k holes is at most this complicated expression, which is of order n to the d. So we have this upper bound. This is the first non-trivial general upper bound that we had for the expected number of k holes. And we somehow suspected that this should be tight, that n to the d should be the right answer. And this is what we proved last year. So we can now show, and this is one of the new results, is that this upper bound is actually asymptotically tight. So we can prove that for any dimension and for any size of our holes, in any convex body of unit volume, the expected number of k holes is at least asymptotically n to the d. So this settles the question about the grow rate of the expected number of k-holes. For any fixed k, we know that this is of order n to the d. So since we settled this asymptotic question, we can ask about the more precise bounds. So now we can focus on these leading constants. So we know that this is some function which is asymptotic n to the d. So now the question is, what is the leading constant in front of this n to the d function? So let's define this constant as the following limit. So it's n to minus d times the expectation. So this is just the leading constant. And now we will try to determine this limit in all the cases that we can. So first of all, let me recall that Reitzner and Temeshwari proved a lower bound on this constant if k is equal to d plus 1, so in the case of empty simplices, and they proved that this is at least 2 over d factorial. Now we can improve this lower bound, but first I need to state one definition. So let PDK be the probability that the convex hull of d plus two points chosen uniformly and independently at random from our convex body is a d-simplex. So this is famous Sylvester's probability studied already in the 19th century. And it's very simple. So you have just your convex body, you draw d plus two points at random, and then you ask what is the probability that one of the points lies in the convex hull of the remaining d plus one points. So this is so-called Sylvester's probability. We define PD as the maximum such probability where the maximum is taken over all the convex bodies. And this PD will play a role in our lower bound on this leading constant. So this is the Sylvester's probability. If anybody has any question, feel free to ask at this point. Okay, I think it's clear. So, and with this probability, I can state our improved lower bound. So for any dimension and every convex body, we know that the leading constant in the expected number of empty simplices is at least 2 over d minus 1 factorial times this probability pd minus 1. So when compared to the previous lower bound, it's an improvement by a factor of d times pd minus 1. Since the probability is pd minus 1 is always at most 1, you can see that this is always improved at least by a factor of d. And also, if you could prove an upper bound on this probability, the stronger upper bound you would have, the stronger lower bound you have here, which is something that I will mention later. What is nice about this bound is that we can show that this is tight in the plane and also for simplices. So in the plane, this will give you the constant 2, which we already know that this is tight. And in free space, we have the following corollary, which says that for any convex body in the free space, the leading constant in the expected number of empty tetrahedra is at most 12 times pi squared over 35. This is actually from the low upper bound by Reisner and Temeshvari, so this was known earlier. And this is actually tight if our convex body is an ellipsoid. And what is new and what we can prove from our theorem 3 is that this leading constant is at least 3. And this is tight if our convex body is a tetrahedron, if it is a simplex. So as you can see, already in the case of empty simplices, this leading constant can depend on the convex body that we are working with. Somewhere between 3 and 3.38 roughly, and it depends what your convex body is. Okay, so those were empty simplices. Again, we can look at this leading constant. If we have holes that are not empty simplices, those are holes that are larger, so if k is larger than d plus one. And if k is larger than that, then the first non-trivial case are four holes in the plane. This is the first non-trivial case that we can look at. And this was already considered in the literature. For example, Fabila, Monroy, Humer, and Mitschke proved an upper bound on this constant, which is never better than 72. 2 years ago, we improved this upper bound to at most 12. So now we know that the leading constant in the expected number of four holes in the plane is at most 12. And as our new result, we can now determine this constant exactly. So we know the precise value of this constant. So this is our fourth result. And it says that for every convex body in the plane of unit area, this leading constant in the expected number of four holes in the plane is exactly equal to, and now you can guess what the number should be. Should be something which is at most 12. You might be surprised when you see the exact value, because I would be very surprised if anybody got it right, because the leading constant is 10 times minus pi squared over 3, which is roughly 3.42. So this is somehow a weird constant, but it is the right value. It's even supported by our computer experiments, where the constant tends to 4.42. And it's somehow surprising that this weird value is the leading constant in the expected number of four holes. For even larger holes in the plane, we don't know or we cannot evaluate the constant precisely. I mean, we have some formulas, we have some integrals that could be in theory evaluated, but the computation would be too difficult. But what we can at least show is that in the plane, this constant does not depend on the convex body. So this is our last main result, which shows that if we are in the plane, then for any size of our holes, so for any k, there is some constant such that for any convex body of unit area, the leading constant in the expected number of k holes in the plane is exactly equal to this c, which again depends only on the size of our holes, not on the convex body. For example, as you can see in theorem 4, it doesn't depend on the convex body, it's just the same for any k. And let me recall that this is no longer true in if our dimension is larger, because this is no longer true for empty symplices in the free space. So those are our main results. Since any talk or every talk should contain at least sketch of some proof, I will show you the sketch of the proof of the fact that the leading constant in the expected number of three holes in the plane is equal to 2. This is the simplest case. This was already proved by Valtr and by Reitzner and Temeshwari. I will show you a technique which combines both approaches, approach of Pavel Valtr and approach of Reitzner and Temeshwari, and it somehow produces the simplest proof of this fact. And it also sketches the methods that we use in the more complicated results. So again, let me recall that we want to show that the expected number of three holes in a set of n points selected uniformly and independently at random from our convex body K is 2 times n squared plus some smaller order error term. So this is what we want to prove. How do we do it? So first, consider 2 points Pi and Pj from our point set S. And now for these 2 points fixed, we count the expected number of 3 holes in our set that have Pi and Pj as the longest edge. So we keep these 2 points fixed and we count this particular 3 holes in our point set, those that have the edge Pi and Pj as the longest one. Without loss of generality, we can assume that Pi is the origin and Pj is point L0 for some positive number L. Otherwise, we apply a suitable isometry. And now the third point of this three hole, let's call it Pk, has to lie in some set R, which is the set of all the possible locations this point can have. And it can be obtained as the intersection of our convex body with this rectangle, and also of the set of points that are in distance at most L from Pi and also from Pj. So the set R defined like this, this is the set of all the possible locations of the third point Pk. The definition of R is somehow complicated, so let me illustrate it on an example, on a picture. So we have our convex body K, it can look for example like this. We have 2 points Pi and Pj from our set S having fixed. Now Pi is the origin, Pj is L0, and first what we look at is this green rectangle. So this is this rectangle right here. And I claim that the third point of our three hole can lie only in this rectangle. Why? Well, if it lies somewhere else, if it lies, for example, here, then this edge is longer than Pi and Pj. But we are interested only in three holes that have Pi and Pj as the longest edge. So this point has to lie in this strip. It cannot lie at a vertical distance larger than 2 over L, because otherwise we would have a triangle, which has area larger than 1. But this is impossible because by convexity, this triangle has to be contained in our convex body K, and our convex body K has a unit volume. So indeed, the third point PK can appear only in this green rectangle. So the intersection of our convex body with this rectangle is the set where Pk can lie. And since Pk has to be a distance at most L from Pi and Pj, the third point can also lie only in this lens. So this is the set of points that are a distance at most L from Pi and also from Pj. So if I take an intersection of this lens together with this green rectangle and with my convex body K, then we will finally obtain this set R of possible locations of my third point Pk. So Pk can lie only in R. It can lie, for example, here. Here I introduce some notation. So for this point Pk, I will define this set Iy as the line segment, which is parallel to Pi and Pj. And Y here denotes the Y coordinate of Pk, because Pi and Pj have a zero Y coordinate. So we have this. In particular, the line segment PI and PJ then corresponds to this set I0, because as I said, they have a zero y coordinate. Now we just have to integrate over all the possible locations of the point PK. We have to integrate over all the points from R. And whenever we have some fixed location of PK, we have to estimate the probability that this red triangle is empty of the other points of S, so that no other point of S falls within this triangle. So let's do the computation. So the expected number of three holes is equal to this. We are summing over all the possible third points. So this is this n minus two. Then we are integrating over the possible y coordinate of this point PK. And the size of this set yi, this is the length of this line segment, then gives us all the possible x coordinates of this point PK. So this altogether gives us the possible location of PK. And then we have to multiply it by the probability that this triangle PI, PJ, and PK is empty in our points at S. So this is just an expression of our expected number of these particle three holes that contain PI and PJ. This probability is equal to this, because the third point, PK, or any point that doesn't fall into this red triangle has to lie in our convex body K, which is unit volume, but it cannot lie in this red rectangle, which has this area. So this is the absolute value of y times L over 2. So this is the possible location of the third point, of the point that doesn't fall into the red triangle. That is n minus 3 of such points. Those are all points of S besides PI, PJ, and PK. So we have to do this to the power of n minus 3. We can do it because our points are drawn independently. So if I plug in this for this probability, then the above integral becomes this. This can be simplified by a substitution, or later simplified, so far it looks more complicated. So we will substitute capital Y as n times small y, and we obtain this integral. And now the key step is to apply Lebesgue's dominated convergence theorem. If we apply this theorem, then we get that for n going to infinity, our integral approaches this expression. And as you can see, this is very nice because we get rid of dependence on n completely. In general, we don't know the length of this line segment, but we do know the length of this. This is just L. This is the length of the edge PI and PJ. So this is L. We get zero here because, as you can see, n goes to infinity, so it brings down this to zero. This expression also gets rid of the dependence on n, because this n cancels with this n, and we get this simple exponential function. And this is an integral which we can already integrate. It's somehow simple to compute, or we can rewrite it first and then compute it, and which shows that this is actually equal to 4. So the expected number of three holes that have PI and PJ as the longest edge is equal to 4. Now we have n choose two pairs PI and PJ. So the overall expected number of three holes in our point set is 4 times the number of these pairs. And this is n choose two up to some small order term, because we have this, we have just this convergence. And if I multiply it, then we get the desired result, which says that the expected number of three holes is 2 times n squared plus some small order term. So this is exactly what we wanted, and this finishes this proof. So it was somehow a quick sketch, but I hope that you at least see the idea and you saw some integrals. In general, the idea is essentially the same, but it's much more complicated. We get, for example, more integrals than that. But as I said, the overall idea, I think, is not that difficult. Okay, so those will be our results together with the sketch of the proof. Let me conclude with some open problems. So first of all, we focused on this leading constant defined as these limits, but I somehow didn't speak about the existence of such limits. And the reason is simple. We don't know whether they exist. So we know that they exist in the plane for any k. We know that they exist for empty symplices in arbitrary dimension. But in general, we do not have an argument that would show that such a limit exists. So I think this is quite nice open problem. Decide whether this limit exists or not. I suspect that the answer is yes. Of course they exist, but we are just missing an argument which would show that they do for any d and for any k. Another open problem. So by our theorem 3, we know that, as I mentioned, any non-trivial upper bound on this Sylvester's probability gives us a strong lower bound on the leading constant in the expected number of empty simplices. Sylvester's probability is very well known. It's studied, as I said, from the 19th century. There are many results about it. For example, for several convex bodies, we know the exact value of this probability. But somehow we are missing a general upper bound. We are not aware of any general upper bound on this simple probability, which is somehow surprising to us, and it might be a good research topic, because if you can prove any actually non-trivial upper bound on this probability, then we would improve our result or our lower bound on this leading constant. We conjecture that this grow rate is of this order. So we conjecture that the Sylvester's probability is at most d times minus d roughly. If this was true, then this is the best result that you can get, because Kingman, for example, proved this or computed this probability exactly for balls. And for balls, this probability grows with this asymptotic grow rate. So this is our first conjecture. Second conjecture, we believe that our lower bound on the leading constant for empty simplices is tied not only in plane and in three space, but in any dimension. So we conjecture that the true value of this leading constant is exactly equal to this expression, which depends on the Sylvester's probability. Again, recall that we know that this is true for the plane and for the three space, but we don't know whether this holds in general. This might be somehow connected to one of the major problems in convex geometry, which says that this probability is maximized for simplices. So this might be somehow a tough problem, but we somehow believe that it might be true. Okay, so that would be it. Thank you very much for your attention. And if you have any questions, feel free to ask.
Okay, so thank the speaker. Thank you for the talk. And now it's time for questions and comments. Okay. All right. So the proof for where you receive this magical constants with pi over 3. So what was roughly the technique of the proof?
It's just an extension of the proof that I showed. We just have, so we have this longest edge pi and pj. In the three holes, we have only one additional point, that was the pk, and we had to take care of its locations. For four holes, we have two such points, like pk and pl. And then we have to track their locations and then just apply Lebesgue's theorem. But because those are two points, it becomes more difficult, because now they depend on each other the positionally, and we have some cases to consider, but it's still computable. But already for five holes, you would have three additional points, and then it becomes really difficult case analysis and difficult to handle, because you even the number of integrals grow. For three holes, we have only one integral. For four holes, we have suddenly, I think, two integrals, or maybe even three. And three, I think. And for five holes, it's even larger than that. And then we are not even sure whether we can evaluate them, actually.
Maybe let me ask, you said that this strange number, this strange constant was even verified by some simulation or whatnot. What are you using for this result?
Yes, so this was done by Manfred Schecher from Berlin. So he has a program in Python, I think, where he has some convex body like a ball or a square or a triangle. And then he randomly draws, I think, those 20,000 points. And then he looks at the expected number of these four holes. And the constant that he got somehow converged to 3.42. So it might be,
fun. All right, any other question? Okay, doesn't seem so. So I think we can thank the speaker again.
Thank you.
And that's probably all for today. So thanks for coming and see you next week, I guess.